All over the internet, on sites like Reddit, Instagram, and even right here on YouTube, there's been a lot of interest in liminal spaces lately. People are fascinated at how a simple picture of an abandoned building can evoke such strong and disturbing reactions. I've seen lots of explanations for this effect, mostly ones that focus on the artistic or the psychological aspects of the aesthetic phenomena. But this video will shed some light on the architectural value of these, from architects and theorists that abhor liminal spaces to those that embrace and even try to replicate their effect in new designs, drawings, and constructions. Stay tuned. Hello, my name is Stewart Hicks, and I lead architectural design studios and lecture courses at the University of Illinois at Chicago. I first heard the term liminal space maybe a decade ago. I don't quite remember the context, but it was a term that we used in our own practice to describe a pavilion that we designed that was made up of all front porches. We described the front porch of a house as a liminal space, a space of transition between the inside and the outside with no singular purpose, but it's appropriate for many. This kind of space is ripe for people to project all sorts of associations onto it, and front porches are important settings in great novels and in important film scenes. But liminal spaces as seen today on the internet are a bit different and a little bit more specific. The term is used to describe images of abandoned buildings of a particular type, usually spaces of commerce, movement, and transaction. The kinds of spaces we tend to pass through and never really notice. Waiting rooms, shopping malls, hallways, Chuck E. Cheese. These relics of the past are often in some state of disrepair because either we don't need them anymore or they don't need us anymore. The photographs of liminal spaces are often staged like we're trespassers, voyeuristically looking in where we're not supposed to. In some ways, I think that these images or the spaces depicted in them are like the uncanny valley of architecture. If you're unfamiliar with the uncanny valley, it's the term that describes the phenomena that humanoid robots can be really creepy. Kind of like the animatronic performers in Chuck E. Cheese. They move and look just close enough to being lifelike, but are just off enough that we find them disturbing. Like they're trying too hard to seem like us, and they probably want to destroy us. The valley is depicted in a graph of appeal as things approach a humanness. The dip is the zone of discomfort. This is related to the explanation of comic drawings by Scott McCloud, where he explains how different resolutions of faces resonate with us in different ways. The face with almost no detail can represent anyone. Everyone can see themselves in a circle with two dots underlined by a bottom section of a circle. But the high-resolution face is only one person. We have to empathize with that character in order to project ourselves into them, and they don't necessarily represent us because they're too specifically themselves. In the middle zone between everyone and no one is where strange things happen. Sigmund Freud actually uses the term uncanny to describe the dread and creeping horror that leads back to something long known to us, once very familiar. It's this sense that something is intimately familiar, but unfamiliar at the same time, which leads to strong reactions of the uncanny. To Scott McCloud, this is also the space of comics, which can create a world that is familiar, but different enough that new and unexpected things can emerge. This helps describe the phenomena occurring with liminal space photographs. They have enough detail so that they're specific, but not enough that we only understand them as one particular place in the world. They're everywhere and nowhere at the same time. That's why so many people talk about these photos provoking a strong sense of nostalgia and memory associations with spaces that they visited before. Even if the viewer has not been to the exact location depicted in the photograph, its qualities lack specific details to the point that it looks like so many spaces that we feel like we've been there before. The French anthropologist Marc Auger coined the term non-place to describe the kinds of spaces and structures that are built for certain ends like transit and commerce and leisure, but that lack identity and connection with the history and culture of their context. Non-places are the opposite of places. Places are where people are meant to meet with each other and offer locations where people establish their own sense of identity. Non-places, on the other hand, are spaces for anonymous transactions and where everyone feels lonely even when they're surrounded by crowds. Airports are often cited as a kind of quintessential non-place. Architects have developed other terms for this kind of space as well. One of the most influential architects of our time, Rem Koolhaas, wrote an essay called Junkspace on the subject. As the title suggests, he's pretty critical of these non-places, and the essay is like a performance piece, written in a way that attempts to make the reader feel the way that junkspace makes you feel, caught in an endless stream of liminal spaces. His endless stream of run-on sentences go,
Junkspace seems an aberration, but it is the main product of the encounter
between escalator and air conditioning, conceived in an incubator of
all
chic rock.
Missing from the history.
Continuity is the essence of junkspace.
It exploits any invention that enables expansion, the infrastructure of seamless escalator, air conditioning, sprinkler, fire shutter, air conditioner, is always interior.
So extensive that you rarely perceive its limits.
Disorientation by any means.
Junkspace is huge, and it is full of absence. It follows no rules. It has no inherent order and no connections between its parts. As Koolhaas suggests, Junkspace is bigger than any one building. It therefore leads to a kind of development and settlement patterns, like the ones that we call the exurbs, which are usually defined by what they are not. They are not rural, they're not urban, and they're not suburban. They're between all of these, the liminal space, filled with data centers, airports, and other anonymous activities like other office campuses and shopping malls. The exurban territory is formless and shapeless and lacks any boundaries. The exurbs are made up of spaces which might be called terrain vague or terrain vague, a term used to describe projects within the marginal wastelands and vacant lots that are located outside the city's productive spaces, the interstitial and the marginal, spaces abandoned by economic forces or in the process of transformation. For a time, some architects tried to see value in the kinds of designs and developments depicted in liminal photographs, and coined the term supermodernism to describe an architecture born from them. As the name implies, it is an intensification of modernism, the movement that emerged from the Industrial Revolution, celebrating technology and emphasizing a break from history through lack of ornamentation and other machinations. The name supermodernism is also fitting with Koolhaas's Junkspace, since he claimed that Junkspace is what remains after modernism has run its course, or more precisely, what coagulates while modernization is in progress, its fallout. Supermodern buildings are often airy and lack ornament, making them appear underdetailed and monolithic. They celebrate technology and a global, universal aesthetic belonging to nowhere in particular. Supermodern buildings are simple resolutions to solving problems of providing space and lack qualities that connect them to a place or even the history of architecture. They're simply there to use and to look slick while doing it. Most of the examples and theories that I've been talking about come straight out of the 1970s, 80s, and 90s, a time where shopping malls and airports seemed like the inevitable next incarnation of public space. Today, that seems a little quaint, and the spaces built during that time are showing their age and also aren't really needed anymore. We have new ways of meeting people in the world, and the vast constructions that were built around these outdated needs are simply sitting empty, ripe to be photographed in their ruinous and worthless state. Some artists have really elevated these kinds of photographs beyond mere snapshots shared on the internet. Boss Princen, for instance, is a photographer that was trained as an architect. He often focuses his lens on buildings and landscapes where it is difficult to tell one from the other. Buildings look like they might be in ruin, or maybe they're in the act of being constructed. If there are people in the photograph, they are dwarfed by the building or the landscape, which looks massive and lacks normal amounts of detail that one would expect. He is fascinated by the imprints of human intervention without necessarily featuring the humans directly. The subject matter of Boss Princen's work is only one component of it, though, and the printing and the viewing of the photograph is an important aspect of how he scripts their engagement. Often his exhibitions will feature printings that are gigantic in size, or printed on materials like cloth, where its texture and behavior is just as important as the photographic content. So the sheer size or the materiality of the image takes on an uncanny quality because the viewer is enveloped in the space of the image itself. Another architectural photographer turned artist is Filip Dujardin. However, he doesn't stop with the snapping of the photograph either. He manipulates the image to create a semi-believable scenes of ultimately unbuildable situations. The depictions often look abandoned and out of place, both for their absurdity, but also for the way that they're staged. While Filip Dujardin uses photographs to make new images of non-existent buildings, architects are creating renderings all the time, which are images of yet-to-be-constructed structures. These are not typically in the realm of art. Rather, they're creating images that depict a building where a viewer is expected to imagine what the building would look like and what it would be like to occupy as a real object in space. Building renderings have existed for hundreds of years in either pencil or through painting, but most recently, people have turned to computers in their creation. At first, the computer's capabilities to produce convincing images was limited. Often depictions would have a bit of an uncanny quality, though, typically through just technological limitations alone, lacking people or convincing lighting. Today, we have the capacity to make renderings that are almost indistinguishable from photographs of spaces. Sometimes a disclaimer is actually required to distinguish them so as to mitigate the possibility of false advertising. But even when we can create these photoreal images, sometimes a visual artist might intentionally create images that incorporate the uneasy feelings of liminal spaces. For instance, Peter Guthrie worked with the architect William O'Brien Jr. to create renderings of the Innie Audi house. While not exactly photoreal, nor a depiction of a shopping mall, the renderings are staged in such a way so as to emphasize the lack of human occupation. For one, we would need to be trespassing and peeking into the house in order to gain the vantage point that we're taking from. Secondly, props and other furniture are staged in such a way that it looks like we just missed someone being there. The ruffled bed, a steaming cup of coffee, they all register the presence of someone that we can't actually see. However, like photography, digital renderings could also be considered a form of art, gaining value beyond their faithful depiction of an architect's intent. And some artists use the most realistic computer and rendering techniques to create intentionally mundane or otherwise off depictions. Artist and architect Sean Miximo employed that strategy in his design for the offices at Paloma Powers, while artist Takeshi Murata creates digital wastelands of unreal spaces that seem both familiar and unfamiliar at the same time. The spaces are devoid of people, populated with props rendered with implausible material choices, all of which challenge our assessments of reality. So liminal spaces feel like they're a singular phenomena that happen while viewing a photograph of an unscripted happenings of abandonment and decay. However, they're part of a recognized and even intentional set of techniques that architects deploy either through misguided faith in technology, skeptical acceptance of undesirable inevitability, or through the space that exists between the image of a building and its material reality in space. So next time you feel that pinch of unease in seeing familiar things treated in unfamiliar ways, pay attention to who's lurking behind it and why they're doing it. If you enjoyed this video, please consider giving it a like. And if you're into seeing more content like this, hit that subscribe button and it will let the YouTube algorithm lords know that you're into this kind of stuff. And I'll know to make a little bit more of it. Thanks a lot.